Welcome, everybody, to the final episode of the Tomoyo After Book Club podcast. I'm still trying to process everything I've just experienced. This is kind of a bit traumatic for me. But we'll take it as we come, eh? Yeah, let's power through. I'm your host, Aspirety, and joining me today we have Pepe, Karifean, and Mogaoscar.
Hello.
Howdy, everybody.
It's kind of worked out that these guys are our regular cast for this podcast. I don't know.
For some reason, that's what happened.
I guess we didn't have that many guest supply.
But hey, I have no problem with you guys, and I hope you had no problem with me, and let's make this podcast to remember, eh?
After finally making it to the good end, we reach the epilogue as everyone goes to pay Tomo a visit until Fate decides to be all like, surprise bitch, and Tomoyo suddenly ends up with anterograde amnesia for no reason. Deciding to take advantage of the situation, Tomoyo spends the rest of the novel trying to make an ignorant amnesiac middle schooler fall for her and getting him to marry her, only to have him conveniently undergo a life-threatening surgery right after. Her plot succeeds and she gets to have the Okazaki family inheritance all to herself, while managing to convince everyone else of how she's this beautiful angel helping everyone. Tomoyo's evil deeds are never exposed to the public, and so we are left with what many consider the most depressing key visual novel ever. The end.
That was 40 seconds, bro.
That was harsh.
But yeah, that was a good recap. Yes. The golden Okazaki family inheritance.
Does she have much to inherit, though?
She has love to inherit. Well, yeah. Anyway, so
there is the secret fortune.
The despair. It's too much.
Anyway, guys. So I guess the biggest part of this after arc is the whole amnesia thing. Well, I mean, for most people, it was. Well, it got them off guard. But what did you guys think of the whole amnesia thing?
Apparently it was even more off guard, like, more abrupt in the original.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Which is interesting to me.
Yeah,
I might as well ask this up front. Am I the only one who read the original first?
I haven't read the original.
I guess you're the only one then.
All right. Well, yeah, in the original, there's no segue bridge. You literally end Tomo arc and Tomoya wakes up with amnesia. It's completely abrupt. And you're thrust right way off into the deep end before you're ready.
I feel like, I don't know which I prefer, the timing of it just like being completely out of nowhere, or the timing of it being slightly built up but then just happening at the worst possible moment. Like right then when we're about to support Tomo, it's like, whoa. It's like just from the frying pan into the fire. It's just wow.
I think it was just sudden enough for it to be impactful, but just not too much for the reveal to be out of place. But
I funny think it's
enough
better,
is that something funny is that reading this bridge in between arcs, I kind of was misled into thinking that Tomoya would end up with paralysis because he had this problem in his hand.
Yeah, I thought that might be MS or something.
Well, either way, I thought the addition of this lead-up was pretty well-placed. It gave us a nice pacing to the amnesia. I myself was not surprised by it because, spoilers, but...
sorry about that.
No, it's not your fault, but... what did... fuck me up was when I learned that it was anterograde amnesia and Tomoyo was helping him remember for 100 years or something like that.
Not quite that long, but
not quite
a long time.
Not quite. That was definitely a what the fuck moment right there. Yeah. Which was cool. It was quite
interesting. And it didn't come out of nowhere either. Like from the very beginning, once you know. Like, it's so obvious.
Yeah, I mean, there are certain things, like, during their whole school life where Tomoyo brings him around school, you wonder, like, why is this, like, why is she going to school like that? Where's Takafumi and Kanako? Why are they all... There's this weird sense that isn't really explained by simple amnesia.
But she just, like, knows more than she should.
Yeah. And more than Kanako and Tech from you would expect, his other friends from Kana to come over.
Well, they
yeah. Maybe not all of them, but at least some.
Yeah.
I guess I'll just mention that on this reread, at the very beginning of the after arc, when Tomoyo wakes up and he's like, "Tomo," and Tomoyo looks at him expectantly, and he follows it up with, "Yeah, Tomoyo."
Damn it!
That just broke my heart.
And especially this coming from this coming from like there, since Tomo was like the who they were planning to see before he collapsed and everything, you would think that maybe he's okay, but no, I guess not.
Tomo arc more or less was the climax of the main story.
Yeah.
After arc is pretty much just what happens after that, and it
after arc is just fuck you.
Well, if you want to look at it that way.
In a sense. Like, it kind of feels like everything was building up to Tomo arc, and it's just like, you thought that everything was resolved, but nope.
It was me.
But I think that's kind of what's beautiful about the movie itself, that everything seems to have a happy ending, but not everything's happy. And after seeing that not everything's happy, you can still find happiness. It's kind of contradictory, but still beautiful to see.
What makes it even more interesting is the fact that you can choose to avoid this completely.
Yes, I love that. I love that so much. Wait. This juxtaposition of the true good end and all the bad ends. Yeah. Where in the bad ends, they keep on living and probably have a lot of
for all intents and purposes, the bad ends are the good ends.
There are no bad ends and good ends. They are just endings.
Yeah. But looking at all of them, I really feel like this is the good end. Even though Tomoya ends up dying. And I think that's amazing how they managed to do that.
At the same time, I think this is also the ending that has the lowest probability of actually happening, because everything has to build up to this ending. Everything has to build up to Tomoya fighting the thugs, to him helping Takafumi win the race, to him actually deciding to build a school and then falling down and hitting his head.
Yeah, it's like the reward for all of his hard work.
Well, that's the thing. It was a freak accident.
Yes.
Especially because many options are about Tomoya powering through and all this, but like bringing Kanako to the town, that was, like you said, a coincidence. That something like that led up to an ending with this.
So I
just didn't have anything to do.
So I guess if you power through, bad things will happen.
It has interesting philosophical and narrative implications when the choices of a player lead to the worst possible ending. And, you know, that's presented as the true ending, more importantly. It's not presented as you fucked up. It's very different to what I'm used to seeing in visual novels, and it's very confronting.
It's because, you pretty much you made all the right choices. It's not like you went wrong anywhere. Because the freak accident is not something anyone could have seen coming, but it just happens. These things happen sometimes. That doesn't mean you have to regret the choices you made.
That's
I think that's definitely what Tomoyo After was going
That's
for.
Exactly true. I mean, the way I look at the visual novels is that every choice, like, there is no good, like, right choice and wrong choice. There are choices that drive the story in certain directions, and some directions have better messages, better outcomes, some directions don't. I think this direction had a very good message for the story, while the other directions had better outcomes, the messages weren't as good. Like, when you despite them actually surviving and living a happy life together, would you have been able to accept like Tomo not finishing things with her mother and Tomoyo quitting school?
Yeah.
Those are also, in a way, very bad things.
Also, about what you said about not regretting what the choices you made. That's kind of a bit of what I brought up in the forum about a bit Nietzsche's philosophy brought into this VM, seeing that Tomoyo made a lot of things, but it could also be applied to the reader. The reader made a lot of choices, and even after he made all the choices, he has to feel proud about what he chose. And if you get the true ending, well, yeah, it led up to pretty bad things, but you should be proud of what you got. And even if you got the happy ending, when I mean happy ending, I mean these bad endings where everyone ends up happy, then, well, they're all happy. You should also feel proud about it. Mm. And I found this theme to be quite interesting, because I could really relate it to a concrete philosopher, and, well, found that shocking to see it in a VN like this one.
I guess what it did well is that it's kind of pushing exactly what I think about visual novels, and which something that I think a lot of people ignore about visual novels. Like, a lot of people say that, hey, bad ends are just bad ends, you shouldn't read them, blah, 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 blah.
They're game over screens. Yeah.
Screens, so you shouldn't That's bother so to get true. Them. And I don't like that. And I hope this pushes more people to actually explore the rest of the world, to explore the outcome of your choices, to accept that it could have happened a different way, and maybe that different way was better. Maybe it was not.
So, since we are now basically witches, do you think the true end is a better outcome or a worse outcome than the other bad ends? Or do you think they're just outcomes, they should be treated as equal?
The latter, yes. For me.
Yeah. For me, the true ending is equal to a bad ending. I mean, the bad end where everyone's happy. But both those are superior to the ones where they are kind of, well, not they don't break up, but Takafumi starts getting far away.
At least we're not in the timeline where Tomoyo gave up because he got horny.
Yeah, please.
that's not a good one. Anyway.
Well, it's also an outcome, I think, just like any
I think the only one who can answer if which is better are the characters themselves, because that's what affects them. I think us as readers have more to learn from this after arc than we would from the quote-unquote happier outcomes. So as readers and as people who read these kinds of stories to get insight, get meaning, I think this was the ending that we need to read.
For me personally, I'd say it leaves a much better aftertaste than the other endings do, even though they end up, you could argue, happier, or at least with more potential for good futures.
But this what I see in all the ends. I mean, because the true end, what we call the true ending, normally is way, way, way more developed than the other, what we call bad endings.
So, I found it very interesting that they put Tomoyo's younger personality into this. It's a Tomoyo That's we've barely right. seen before. I think the only time we really saw him was in Kotomi's route in Clannad.
And well, like, even that was a much different Tomoya than the one we see here. This is a phase from his life we've only ever heard him narrate about, but never witnessed firsthand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right before team up, he's a bit older than the one in Kotomi's route. He's about to get into high school. So yeah, it's very jarring almost that you expect all these sort of adult emotions and responses from Tomoya, and they're just not there for the most part. They kind of come in later, which was maybe a bit convenient, but like, I feel like the whole thing with like him seeing the wedding ring and like suddenly being an adult was a bit contrived.
What I liked about this kind of reason that the amnesia brought to Tomoyo's personality is that there's a lot of character development in Tomoyo through pretty much all the routine planets, but also in Tomoyo After, especially during the first and second arc. And I found it interesting how all these character development was kind of erased at first, but he regained it during these short amounts of times, that those weeks were a bit more aware. So I found it, I love how they detail like a fast character development in a pretty weird situation that you wouldn't find in an everyday life.
Did he regain his development?
I can't say that he regained his development. I just say that he developed in a different way. One that was like...
Yeah, he didn't get the exact same one, but still. I think it's quite meaningful. Mm.
I think it was believable that he fell in love with Tomoyo all over again.
Yeah,
I can believe that.
Yeah, definitely.
Which is also why they are my key OTP, by the way.
All right, sure. I mean, if it was Nagisa, I'm sure he would have done that. Anyway.
It is so awkward, though, when they're, like, trying to be affectionate, and Tomoyo's just like, whoa, I'm with a hot babe, what the fuck?
That is what that is what the middle schooler would probably say. Although, after all of these loops, what was it that actually made him... finally fall in love with her that, you know, was not in the other...
That's a good question. Yeah, that's a good question.
Well, I guess I'll start from the fact that I think he fell in love with her in pretty much every loop.
Okay, I can agree with that.
I think he just didn't have the courage to voice it.
Okay. What made him have the courage then?
Nagisa.
We go into that. Yeah, she's not Nagisa, but...
In a way, it's still Nagisa who gave him the courage. And it's kind of ironic that it ended up being her in a visual novel that literally doesn't have her anywhere. But yeah, I think it was...
I love this interpretation.
And that is why I still...
I think it was.
Anyway, I agree with you 100%, Karifean. I was sneakily leading you into saying that, but anyway. So, I do honestly believe that this encounter with Ogawa is what gave him the courage to tell Tomoyo that, hey, I love you. And it's not as simple as him...
What is that, Pepe?
It's not as simple as him, you know, actually having someone to, you know, encourage, thus encouraging himself. I think it also leads back into the beginning of Clannad, where I think it points out just how life-changing the beginning of Clannad was, when he says that he should... When he tells Nagisa to keep on going, that he should... she should find more happy things in life, etc. I don't believe that Clannad could have happened without him doing that pushing, in the same way that I don't believe this him saying I love you to Tomoyo could have happened without him pushing. Because Tomoyo himself is very insecure about his own personality. So by him being able to support someone else, he gives this confidence to, well, support himself. So by supporting someone else, he can support himself, is what I'm saying.
I quite like that interpretation, and I pretty much agree with it.
Like, going back into... I'm going to make a callback to our After Story podcast, where... If you remember, we mentioned that Tomoya himself, like, Tomoya supporting someone like that is very out of character from him. We see him as this person who hates this town, and in this after arc, we see him as a middle schooler who knows nothing about what's happening. And the question remains, why did he do that? And I subtly hinted back then how this is connected to the imaginary world, and I think
illusionary world.
The illusionary world, And I think this illusionary world is somehow driving his development to encourage others. Like, this illusionary world is telling him that he should, that this girl on the hill you should support, even though it's a different girl, it kind of works. And this connection to the illusionary world does not disappear after his amnesia. In fact, I think it gets reset. I think it's the illusionary world that caused him to encourage Ogawa and thus drive his development towards
the ending. This is a bit more of a wild theory, because there's not a lot of evidence to support it.
Not a lot of evidence.
Oh, it's a theory.
But it's a theory. A game theory.
But that said, pretty much everything you say, they're just theories.
But wasn't there an indication... Wasn't there an indication that Tomoyo remembered Nagisa?
I don't think so.
Yes, there is one line that implies that it strikes a chord somewhere inside him.
And I think that chord
push
is
someone forward like that.
I guess it's because I think that chord is his connection to the illusionary world.
It's a very
I definitely don't think the illusionary world is connected myself, but it's an interesting take.
Well, now that you brought up After Story and Planet so much, what do you guys think that is different, and what makes the After Arc better or worse than After Story?
Well, they actually had the balls to go through with a sad ending. That's kind of a big deal. I'm actually, like, major respects to them for that. Like, I really wanted to see a clonard where Nagisa died, maybe Ushio died, maybe not, but at the very least, like, keep Nagisa's sacrifice and, like, make that a point to drive the story forward instead of just making it all better in the end. I'm being very harsh on clonard here, because I know that there's, like, a lot that happens there and that it wasn't completely erased or anything like that. It still all happened. But I still would have liked to see the final result of his actions there in a world without Nagisa. I feel like that would have been incredible to see. But instead, like, they kind of just stopped it when Ushio dies. Like, that's the end of that timeline. Whereas
I
this
get
one,
where you're coming from.
Yeah. This is the kind of the ending I wanted.
I
agree with what you said, Aspi, and especially with the part that I would like to see Tomoya acting as Tomoyo in the After Arc after Nagisa died. But Ushio's death wasn't necessary. I mean, the same message as in the After Arc would be conveyed if Ushio hadn't died. And he just kept on living with Ushio, saying that, well, I lost something very important, but there are still beautiful things. So... life is beautiful, but it's like a melody.
It's a wonderful life.
see, this is why I can't get myself to agree, because that right there, that life is beautiful, life is like a melody, that is the message of Tomoyo After. That is not the message of Clannad. I think that if in Clannad they extended his life and showing him continue living despite what happens, I think that is a totally different message that we would learn from Clannad. And so, going back into the question of whether I thought this was better or worse, I think neither is better or worse. It's just that they both had different intents, and I think both stories were able to convey their intents fairly well.
Yeah, and at the same time, I agree with Aspi that I personally prefer this kind of ending message, whatever you want to call it.
I guess personal preferences put into play, then sure. I personally prefer After Story because I thought it was more impactful with its message. That's all personal.
Well,
yeah, it's personal. For me, the After Arc was better in a way that it had a deeper message, at least for me. But then After Story was a lot more emotional and really struck a chord It was something special.
So stories that make you think versus stories that make you feel.
Well, but maybe here's while we're on the...
Oh, yeah.
I have a crazy theory, guys.
Yes, Aspie?
What if Jun Maeda wrote After Story as kind of a post-mortem of, like, I wish I could have, like, ended Clannad a bit more like this? He had regrets over how Clannad's ending was handled, and this is what was resulted.
Well, I'm sure if he wanted to end Clannad a certain way, he would have. I mean, he had...
That's not true at all! That goes against Jun Maeda's character.
Let's just say it's one of the few times a Jun Maeda story actually ends on a pretty, arguably, sad note, at least plot-wise.
Okay, well...
It didn't revert it. That's the most important part.
Yeah.
But I would have been perfectly happy if Tomoyo survived, but I was expecting sort of a situation where maybe, like, he became... Like, he lost his mind. Like, maybe he had Alzheimer's or something. And just, like, he was, like, physically... He still lived on, but he would just be, like... His mind would be gone. I was expecting an ending like that, but no, they just... They straight up killed him.
Alright, actually, let's get into that.
Yeah, okay.
That's arguable.
Let's argue about that. Did he die? Ta-da-boom!
Alright, so before that, I'd like to give you some context, because there is actually quite a bit of change that went into every version past the first release here. And the most obvious and, I guess, important one is the final epilogue, where Tomoyo and Tomoya have a conversation about how he kept her waiting all this time, and now they'll be together. Which implies a few things, depending on your interpretation of where this actually takes place.
Okay.
But also, overall, in Tomoyo's final epilogue, it generally gives you more of a feeling that something has ended, that something permanent took place, that they won't walk together again. She says so explicitly that they will never walk together again. So, and that line doesn't appear that, at least not like that, in this version. So quite a bit of change has gone into this ending. And you could argue that this time it sounds more like Tomoya survived, whereas in the original ending it sounds a lot more like he ended up dying.
Maybe they're just trying to protect that ambiguity.
I think,
which kind of goes out the window when you consider the original ending and what they were going for.
I mean, even if the original ending is more implicative of his death, it still doesn't necessarily confirm that.
Yes, it doesn't confirm it.
He could be paralyzed. Yeah, he could just be paraplegic. Yeah,
when I first read it, my first thought was like he was in a vegetative state where he couldn't talk or he couldn't do anything as a human anymore.
The first time I read it, I thought he went into a coma, but then he awoke and after some time just lived a normal life. But what I liked about it is that all this information, I got it from both the music and the CG, not the text. I saw their hands together. I saw Tomoyo not seeing Tomoyo at a point, though that's not explicitly the ending. I saw the host was very ethereal, you say so. So combining all this, though the first time I thought that he survived, this ethereal feeling of the host and the fight and the faded out borders of the CGs made me think that this was more of something, a dream, an imagination, or something that took place in heaven.
That is definitely a valid interpretation. Maybe he did die.
It's very reminiscent of the promise scene in Clannad After Story.
Yep.
Yep.
Like, where did that take place, right?
The boundary between life and death or something. But yeah, like, here's a question, Karifean. Did the CG with them both, like, standing up holding hands, did that happen in the original?
No. That entire epilogue did not happen.
Interesting. Well, that helps my theory then.
I think that...
I mean, there are more reasons why I believe he's dead in both versions, I should say. Because, for one, there's the lyrics of Life is Like a Melody. I don't know if you read the subtitles as the credits were scrolling, but it basically talks about someone moving on even when they're all when they end up all alone.
Yeah.
Yep.
I mean, even...
That's true.
Even if he doesn't die, let's say he stays into a coma, she would remain all alone.
I don't think she would call herself all alone.
I feel as if it's the same way. She views Tomoya as a means of her support. So with him not being there to support her, then she would feel very much alone.
Well, there's enough there to protect that ambiguity, but yeah. I think it's more or less clear what they were going for.
I honestly think that at the end of the day, yeah, it doesn't matter.
I kind of agree that they left it up to the reader to decide for themselves, but I think that what the writers were going for is that he died.
Well, mm-hmm. you could definitely argue that. And again, I'm saying, at the end of the day, I think it doesn't affect the story and the message. I think even if he died, or if he went to a coma, I think it still hooks onto that message that despite all the bad shit that happens, life is still beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Karifean had something to say about it. Right?
What?
Oh, didn't you... I thought you said that... the Tomoya dying gave the message
a
much powerful meaning, and that it would reach more people than something like that.
I mean,
right?
I think in some ways I can agree with Pepe that it doesn't matter whether he died or not, but the point is that they can only really make that point if he dies. I don't know if that was just a really confusing sentence I just said, or if it made any sense, I think if Tomoya does end up surviving, it kind of defeats the message for people where that didn't happen, where no miracle occurred, where their loved ones did in fact die from that 50% chance. Mm-hmm. Whereas if he dies, then you could argue that it works for both.
I see what you mean. I see what you mean. That's a very rare case. Like, I'm coming at this from a perspective of someone who isn't in that that horrible situation.
Someone who hasn't lost a loved one.
I think even if you're not in that horrible situation, whether he dies or not, like, I think you can still take from that message in the same way, which is how I took from that message.
Well, perfect.
I agree with you. I think the core message doesn't change. It's a lot more power rather than
message. Touché.
This is a message to people who have lost their loved ones and are struggling to find meaning in life. That is what I believe to be the core aspect of Tomoyo After. And I feel like this was especially communicated well in that whole typing scene where it kind of doesn't, but kind of like does a nod to the reader.
Speaking of that typing scene, it turns out that it was Tomoyo all along.
Yes, it was. Well,
I wasn't expecting that.
You could definitely see that she was... They did hint at it, but you could definitely see how she was using the internet as a means to help people, because she wanted to help people. And I guess it's exactly these kinds of people, the people who have lost loved ones, the people who don't know if they should continue living. Those are the kinds of people that she wanted to reach out to with her final message. So, in a way, yes, we are readers, but also we are not exactly the readers that she wanted to reach out to, unless you are one of those people.
But we are the readers that Maida wanted to reach out to.
Yes, sure.
And this is where I think this arc turns incredibly beautiful, because you can collapse the reader base of Tomoyo's forum posts and the reader base of Maida's work Tomoyo After more or less into one. And it just works. And I love it.
Yeah, it's very clever.
Hey, don't forget Leo Kashida. He might have been the one who figured this thing out.
Who?
Yeah, I'm really like feel bad for like sucking my dick all the time.
Hey.
Leo Kashida is just as important in this, and we need to not forget that.
Yuga said that the message is mainly addressed to the people who have been or are in these difficult situations.
Mm-hmm.
But even if you're not in those situations, you could take the message, or not the message, but you could find inspiration in Tomoyo, because she went through all that, she endured it, but she didn't just endure it and felt happy about life afterwards. She went on, she did something more. She tried, well, and helps people through the internet, through, well, whichever, in any means she can. She always tries to help people. And I found this very interesting, because if you're not, you don't have any problem, you can find the inspiration there. You can maybe become a bit like Tomoyo, and even though you're not in a bad situation, you can help the ones who are in that situation.
Mm-hmm. One of my favorite scenes in this VN was the week where Tomoyo gave up.
Yes.
That was
which
amazing
was not in the original.
Also?
Wasn't it? Really?
No.
Really?
Was the original any good?
Sounds like the original was
if you
good
ask me, the original was even better.
Because the best,
that's because
the best
I'm
scenes
hilariously
are
biased.
Okay.
I can't find myself agreeing based on what you've said, Karifean. I'm sorry.
Well, it just has a completely different pacing.
This was a great moment, like just the utter despair that she feels, where like her entire world turns grey and she has lost sight of the beauty of life, is so powerful, especially considering this is Tomoyo we're talking about. She's generally, you know, such an optimistic and go-getter personality. Just to see her reduced to that is incredible. Incredibly sad, but incredible nonetheless. And that, then you have the scene where she's finally like looking on the internet and seeing all these people who are hurting and in pain, and she's like, she realizes then she's unable to comfort them because she has lost sight of her own purpose in life. But that's eventually, she does reach that point where she can reach out to them once more, which is so damn beautiful. And I actually think that makes the ending so much better for me.
Yeah, this was an amazing scene. Everything, it was so powerful. I don't know how to describe it. It was my favorite one. But one thing that I really think helped there is this track from the Lost Memories, when she just recovered and noticed what she had been doing this last week, and spent the next week crying.
She spent a whole week crying.
Yeah. But even though it feels funny and kind of weird, I think it's also powerful from itself that after. Mm.
And how many loops didn't we see with just inane shit happening?
A shit ton. Like,
maybe she gave up several times. We don't know.
They never said. How long do you think she went through that?
They said 3 years.
Yeah.
They did? Well, fuck me then. Okay.
And that's ridiculously long. Like, that's 150 repeats she's gone through.
That's crazy.
Well, you gotta thank Ogawa then.
And gotta hand it to Tomoyo. She's amazing.
Well, okay, yeah.
But is she too amazing?
It is Tomoyo.
No.
Tomoyo Gushing Kona. So, definitely her strength in being able to do this kind of thing is something you wouldn't expect from many other characters. And I think her growth and, like you said, her message with Tomo in the past arc is what was able to drive her to be able to do this. If we didn't have the rest of Tomoyo After, then it wouldn't be as believable that she would push through with everything like this, you know?
That is true. Yeah. I'll give you that.
I think it works because Tomoya is a well-written character. Like, you get to know her over the course of her own route and the entirety of Tomoyo After, and when you get to this arc, it just feels like something Tomoyo can do. And not because she's a Mary Sue and has no flaws, but because she's an actual person and that's one of her strengths.
God damn. Canon isn't here, so I'm not gonna elaborate on that because I've never seen Tomoyo as a flawless person. In fact, ever since I interacted with her in Clannad, I thought she was an extremely flawed character.
Anyway. Canon just doesn't like that the story presents her as like this ideal person, she's so great, this is like the kind of person you should be.
I never thought that the story was pushing it that way.
I don't think it was that bad.
Anyway, but yes, she is flawed, and despite her flaws, she was able to overcome her flaws. And
yeah, overcoming flaws isn't equivalent to being perfect, guys.
Yeah. Anyway, that's true. Anyway, she was able to overcome her flaws and do this, live for, like, support Tomoya for 3 years.
The fact that both Tomoya and Tomoya are able to acknowledge Tomoya's flaws in this arc and the build-up to it is amazing. They've finally reached the point where almost, like, Tomoya can consider himself on equal footing with Tomoya.
Mm.
Maybe not an athletic ability, but, yeah, it's like, I find he looks up to her a lot less right before the accident happens, and yeah, the fact that we're able to see Tomoyo as this very flawed person, especially with this week where everything went to shit, I feel like, yeah, it gives a lot more meaning to what she had to go through to get to that point. And, alright, can I steer this in a different direction?
Sure.
Naoyuki.
Oh,
Papa.
Yes.
Oh, man.
It was interesting because of the different ways they handled the team, the after compared to after story. It's, well, the situation's really different. Here.
It's so sad that Tomoya actually, like, came to terms and, like, accepted Naoyuki in Tomo arc, and now all that's gone. It's kind of regressed back.
Yes, but that's something to be expected.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's so sad.
But I like how it was. I mean, it gives more meaning to how Tomoyo started hating more than disliking his father at some point. Or either in Clannad or just before Clannad began. And I think that's just great because now Yuki wasn't really a bad father. About father, after all, it's stated both in After Arc and After Story. And when we see that Tomoya has no memories of the accident he had with his shoulder and everything, it's interesting to see how he reacts in a radically different way. It's true that Tomoyo eventually tells him about his shoulder, but even then, since she just told him, he didn't experience it himself. The outcome was very different, and seeing Tomoya not reconciled with his father, but kind of thinking of him as a respectable person, that's something, yeah, notorious, at least.
I think the After Arc in general gives us a good perspective on what kind of relationship Tomoya and Naoyuki had before the accident. Which we never really got in that way in Clannad, because, I mean, one of his first lines after he wakes up in After Arc is, "Why is this lady looking after me instead of my old man?" It's like, they're still close enough that he expects him to be there,
yep.
And doesn't even really think to question that he wouldn't be there for whatever reason.
And I guess it kind of strengthens how this accident is exactly what changed the relationship between Tomoya and his father.
Yeah. It's what made it go to shit. But still, it was really nice seeing Naoyuki appear later on in the arc, especially since, well, his son kinda got married.
And his sprite is the same as the one in Clannad.
Is it?
Is it? Isn't it?
Yes.
Is it? It is, it is.
Huh.
The only one they reused.
Yeah, I guess so.
Speaking of which, Tomoya has a sprite!
Yeah!
What the fuck? I was not prepared for this when I read this, because none of those flashbacks happen in the original.
I guess I was like, really...
where the fuck did this come from?
I guess it like really helps to dissociate you from Tomoya. It's like, he's become another person.
Yeah.
It's creepy. It's unsettling.
He's not the protagonist anymore.
He also looks creepy.
And yeah.
This was how... Yeah.
Yeah, go on.
Okay. This is kind of what I meant when I said before that it was interesting to see Tomoya's previous personality or true young personality when he just woke up without having experienced many things. And well, one of the things that changed was his relationship with his father. And this consequence of amnesia, for instance, was one of the ones that made Tomoya's character doing this after maybe not original, but different enough from the Tomoya we are used to know, so that it's a refreshing feel.
Yeah. But Naoyuki is not the only Clannad throwback here, nor is Ogawa. Yeah. There's a lot, and I mean a lot of Clannad throwbacks in this arc.
Mm-hmm.
To me, it actually felt pretty nostalgic after doing the Clannad book club earlier in the year to come back to it now.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
So we had also
references to Misae, to Sunohara.
Yeah, we had references of Misae, especially Sunohara, and we learned later on that Sunohara tries to connect to Tomoya, and it was, I think that was for me
that
one
was
of
heartbreaking.
The yeah, that was one of the saddest parts of his amnesia. The fact that even Sunohara gives up on him, and you know Sunohara's personality, he wouldn't give up that easily. He didn't give up trying to find Tomoyo's fake boobs.
What really got me was a whole line about how, like, even I wouldn't have a place to come back to now.
Yeah, oh my god.
That was the only voiced line of Sunohara in the entire novel, and it rips your heart out.
Oh,
yes.
Sunohara.
And also seeing how Clannad's theme of relationship or family being something important even beyond blood races, if you say so. Here, seeing Sunohara caring so much about Tomoya, but after all, you take notice that Sunohara doesn't belong to that town or to that city. He was there just for some time in his life. He went there also partially because of the soccer. He lost the soccer. He got bad grades. He had nothing apart from Tomoya, and even Tomoya was.
And now he has nothing. Sunohara! You the real MVP. Sunohara after everyone.
Did anyone else break slightly on the inside when Tomoyo started asking Tomoya if he liked the school?
Like, what the fuck, Tomoya? You don't just drop a line like that.
Oh my god.
Do you like this school?
Burncast says
really,
he just
really
got
really
fucking destroyed and had to stop breathing.
Yeah, I don't blame you. That's just...
All I needed was, like, one of the Clannad BGMs to play there, and I'd just, like, probably start crying.
Surprisingly, I was not as affected by it.
I mean, it carries so much different meaning in a way, too, because they made memories here, and now they're gone.
Shit,
like,
sucks.
Do you like the school? I really do. I hope you do too.
Not really, I just got here.
Oh my god.
For some reason, I thought that Tomoyo was going to dump Tomoyo at that point. I thought that she was just trying to parent you and see any results that she was going to have.
See, when I was reading this route, like, once okay, so the plot I was kind of expecting it to go down was a sort of situation where Tomoyo is desperately trying to get Tomoyo's memories back, but Tomoyo, like, he's not going to get them back, and so it's kind of a fruitless effort. And so I was expecting a sort of ending where it's like Tomoyo starts making new memories, but that's not what happened at all. My hopes were completely dashed by the end of it. It was much worse than I expected.
Yep.
It wasn't retrograde amnesia at all.
And on that note, do you think the Tomoya romance is... Do you like it? Do you think it's believable? That they really do love each other this much?
Even from Clannad, it was my favorite one. So, there you have my answer.
I mean, yeah, I agree, but I want to hear what Aspie and Pepe have to say about it.
Okay, so just putting it on the table, the OTP will forever be Nagisa and Tomoya. Nothing will change that. However, a lot, and I remember this discussion from back in the Clannad when we were in Clannad, a lot of people liked the Tomoya and Tomoyo's romance because they were both broken in a way, right? And this after arc, I thought this is something they did very well, is they showed Tomoya in his unbroken state still being able to fall in love with Tomoyo, and I think that that kind of hooks onto the romance a lot, and I think it was telling the readers it's not him being broken that made him fall in love with Tomoyo, you know? I think even Tomoyo herself was doubting this because she thought that, oh, this was the only thing that we had that we could relate to and now it's gone. How will you ever love me? And that was her, like, her biggest internal conflict in the route. And TLDR, this story proves that that is not what got them to fall in love with each other. There's more to their love than just, you know, being broken, than just having a relatable experience. And
there's Nagisa.
Yes, because if you didn't talk with Nagisa and Tomoyo, you wouldn't have gone. Anyway. God damn it. Yeah. You broke my groove, man. You broke my groove.
I'm sorry.
Anyway, I honestly thought that even back then, this was not the only thing to their love. I thought that it was definitely a believable romance. I wouldn't say it's better than all the other, let's say, roots in Clannad, because I also thought that, say, his relationship with Kyo was believable. Even his relationship with the Misae. No, let's not get into Fuko.
Well, I mean, the major difference here is that with Tomoyo and Nagisa, you actually see them progress after the getting together stage.
Yeah.
Like, they're a couple, and you see that. Yeah. You see how they interact with each other. So
we also see that
that's something that only Nagisa.
We also see that with Tomoyo.
And Tomoyo.
We also see that with Tomoyo.
Yeah, I mean up to this point.
So if you ask me, like, if Tomoya and Nagisa was not a thing, would I think that Tomoyo is the best romance? I can't say because I think it's just as good as the others, but it was definitely 100% believable. It's not something that they just pulled out of their ass just so they can make a character root.
Okay. Because to me personally, it's pretty fascinating in a way to see how Tomoya and Tomoyo have like a very different kind of relationship from the one Tomoya and Nagisa have. I guess the best way I can put it is I feel like Tomoya and Nagisa bring out the best of each other's strengths, while Tomoya and Tomoyo help each other mitigate their weaknesses. At least that's the vibe I get from them. Tomoya and Nagisa help each other be the best people they can be in what they can do, while with Tomoya and Tomoyo, it's more that they can keep each other's flaws in check.
That's definitely something I love how you put it, and that that's definitely something I only see in Tomoyo After. If let's say just the clanad roots, if we're talking about just the clanad roots, not even considering After Story, I can't say that for Tomoyo, but I can say that for Nagisa.
Yeah, it's hard to say what the romance with Tomoyo did for Tomoya positively in Tomoyo Root because the route just kind of ends there.
But yeah, I love the way you put it.
So we're approaching the end of the podcast now. I think we should start talking about closer to the ending.
Can we all agree that the final monologue of text is one of the most beautiful things ever? I don't think there's a scene in Key that made me cry as much as this one.
That's a very personal thing.
That is very subjective.
Well, yes. But it's just everything worked so well for me, from the message to literally just the way she writes her words. It just clicked with me.
And I feel so...
So you're talking about the typing scene?
Yes, the typing
scene. Yes.
I thought you were talking about the final epilogue.
No.
Oh, no.
Because that was in the origin.
Okay. Yes, that was fucking beautiful. Of course it was. That was amazing. How is there room to criticize this?
I definitely don't criticize it, but...
Like, my only criticism is maybe that they told too much and didn't show enough. Like, I really would have liked to see a little bit more of Tomoyo after this juncture in her life, but...
Oh man, I thought that worked so well!
I mean, in a novel like this, in the setup, like, it's typing through a message board or a blog or something, so that's really the only way they could have done that.
I still keep my opinion on that. In the after art, they focus a lot on the message, but still, the emotion wasn't entirely complete.
And I think the whole point of this is showing that Tomoyo can still find beauty in life even after everything she's gone through. Like, Tomoyo ended up giving her the strength there to carry on. And I think that was largely due to them getting married and everything that happened after. I think that one final scene, which was apparently a hate scene in the original,
was they beautiful. Consummate their marriage in the original, and it's beautiful there too.
Yeah, it's
each just... scene's done well. Maybe
I love how like Tomoya is so anxious about losing his life to a point, but then basically he comes to peace with it. And he, at that point, he's only worrying about Tomoyo. Which I think is very reflective of people with terminal illness, so in my experience, of just... You know, after a point, it stops... You gotta stop thinking about yourself, because you're not gonna matter in a few days.
Mm-hmm.
Your emotions won't exist anymore. Only the people you've left behind will matter, so... You can't really be selfish when you're gonna die. It's just... It doesn't make sense. Psychologically. I feel like that's definitely a thing I can't say I've experienced myself, but I've read a lot about stories about that. And I think that's definitely one of the more poetic sort of takes that Key has had on a death in a, in its series before, that really got to me hard. Then I always latch on to these sort of topics in Key games, so that's just me.
There's one more reason as to why Tomoyo After is so important to me in the context of Key visual novels in general. And that is, I feel that in Tomoyo After, more than in any other Key visual novel, the writer just really speaks to the reader personally and directly conveys his intentions to them. Like, we've already talked about this a bit when we talked about the final monologue and how she directs lines at the person on the other side of the screen, which is both the reader and an in-universe mm-hmm. character, you can imagine. But it goes beyond just that. Like, the entire plot of the After arc, Tomoya having amnesia leads to Tomoyo showing him around her world, not his world, but her world for a bit, and trying to get him to affirm his feelings for her.
Mm-hmm.
That, to me, feels kind of like an author wanting to entice a reader with their story, and wanting them to understand them through this story. And it doesn't work out a lot, but sometimes it does. That's what the miraculous week where he does recover his memories symbolizes to me.
Alright. Sometimes it takes something inside the person for that to, you know, actually reach. And again,
although it's a rare occurrence, it's worth it.
It'll definitely not reach
several times.
It won't reach everybody.
Maybe they'll form a community.
Wait, what?
And maybe if it reaches several people, they'll form a community around it.
The
fact that our community exists is sort of testament to this, that Tomoyo After accomplished its goal. Maybe many of us hadn't read the story until now, and maybe many of us still haven't read the story. Sure, but the fact is that Key stories have managed to communicate such deep messages to all of us that we are inspired to come together as a community to celebrate them. And I think that's truly amazing. I think that Tomoyo After is very symbolic of Key's hopes and goals, almost, in sort of communicating messages like this to the reader, especially with ideas of family and community and
as a Key enthusiast myself, this was just so beautiful to me.
So I guess the final question I want to pose before we wrap up this podcast, I might just ask Karifean, what does Tomoyo After mean to you?
It's the perfect example of why I love Key stories. They're filled with earnest, meaningful messages that the author wants to convey to the readers, and it hits you with a hard emotional impact on top of that, and it has wonderful characters that you can relate to and or at least get lost in their stories. It's just... It's shorter than the other Key visual novels, and most of them at least, and it still manages to hit everything I like in a Key visual novel. And that's amazing to me.
Yeah, I almost wish that Key would do shorter stories like this more often. Shorter linear narratives.
Well, there's a new Key story coming out finally, and it's going to be a short one, a short linear one, which I'm sure will have an impactful message. And it's known as Harmonia, coming out next week, September 23. Are you all hyped for it? Yeah!
Fuck yeah.
I stole the thunder.
We've dated our podcast forever now, guys. Good job. So yeah, wow, we're riding off the coattails of this first novel and right into a completely new one. It's pretty amazing time to be a Key fan. I think, like, with Tomoyo After, obviously, it has a lot more meaning for Karifean than it does for me, but that doesn't mean this hasn't touched me deeply. I'm just very tired because I didn't get much sleep. Anyway, the way that everything it built up with Tomoyo Arc was exceptional to me. The whole idea of overcoming impossibilities through sheer willpower, and the idea of wanting to overcome adversity instead of running away from it are all messages I really dig. And then After Arc comes and throws everything out of the window, and it's like, what's your just rewards for all of this? You get a horrible... You get cancer, basically. I don't know if it was exactly cancer, but why not? Let's call it Key AIDS, whatever you want to call it. And this horrible thing happens, and it's nobody's fault. Nobody can claim to have caused it. It's just a horrible accident. And that shit happens. Not everything needs a dramatic explanation like you might expect. Like, it's such a true-to-life where we're living out our own lives like a narrative, and then something horrible happens, and then we want to blame something. We want a reason, like maybe we're being punished by God, or maybe there's somebody who indirectly caused this. We want something to blame, and we want to put a cause to that so we can direct our anger and frustration. But that doesn't always happen. That's sometimes things just happen and there's no deeper reason to it. Maybe it's like this is going against certain religious aspects, but I don't want to get into that. I just want to, like, Tomoyo After really encapsulates the sort of conflict that happens in so many people's lives, and it's so beautiful then that we can actually come out of this stronger people despite all the horrible despair we've had to go through. It's beautiful. It's such a beautiful message that it's tackled similarly. Like, similar messages have been tackled in Key games before.
Yep.
But this might be the most heavy-handed approach I've ever seen it, and it hits hard.
And again,
it's draining, but it's also so remarkable.
I think it does its job well. Bravo, Tomoyo After. You were a good read. You were not just a fan disc.
That's so important, isn't it?
Yep.
So many people dismiss this story because of all the H content at the start, all the etchy content.
Many people.
And people just think, it's just for the Tomoyo. It's just for the Tomoyo fans. Like, it's just there to appease people that wanted to see more Tomoyo. And that so isn't true.
Nope. it's a key story in and of itself.
This version novel is.
Yep.
Next time. Kudo After Book Club.
No! It's
the best Key novel ever.
No!
So are we going to do the Light Colors versus One Switcher?
That's not the same as Tomoyo After. It's sad because I've tried to defend that so many times. Look, you can't know until you play it.
And then he yourself will play it.
And he doesn't have a very good opinion. So that's not leaving a good taste in my mouth.
Anyway. But
don't let that influence your opinion of Tomoyo After. Like, I'm going to make it my mission from now on, whenever we talk about Key with someone, I'll be like, have you read Tomoyo After? And they're going to be like, no. And then I'm going to be like, did you like Clannad? And like, yes. Then fucking read it, because it's a short visual novel. It won't take you a billion years like Clannad did. Like, even if you've seen the anime, you can still just jump into Tomoyo After. It's more content, more of the characters you love. But it's different. And it's amazing. It's beautiful. And it's just, I want everybody to know this. So I'm glad that I finally read Tomoyo After.
I have no regrets either.
I tell them it's a different approach to After Story. Yeah.
Mm.
Everyone should read it. Everyone was
red kind of. Anybody who likes sad stories, you know, it's just. As long as you've watched Clannad, the anime, then I think you're eligible.
Specifically the Tomoyo Another World episode. You'll have to watch that, definitely.
Oh, yeah, that's true. But, yeah, just if you... I don't know, maybe we didn't get as much attendance in this book club as I would have liked. That doesn't mean I'm going to stop trying to get people to read this. And when they do, maybe they'll even listen to these podcasts. Yeah. Who knows? So, well, I think we've done our work well.
I'm sure that through this book club, we've gotten a lot of people to start reading Tomoyo After, and it's great. Shout out to the people on the forum who have been participating ever since the beginning. People like Aizen Kobu, Dango Daikazuku, Mogaoscar... Yeah. Even October Pumpkin, who we haven't seen in a while, Black Hayate. Bonkus hasn't been posting, but he's been actively following us. So,
did you mention Sonic?
Yeah, also Sonic. Sonic. I don't remember the numbers.
Helios and Cloud showed up a few times.
If you're watching this on video, I'd just like to show, this is all of the fan art we have accumulated over the course of this book club. I even like hosted a giveaway to incentivize people to get their art in, so that's really helped out too. But thank you so much to everybody who created artwork for this book club. I enormously appreciate it, and we'll be definitely including some of your contributions in the key. So thank you so much. There's some pretty good drawings there. I'm quite happy with the result. And I've already contacted a couple of you with prizes, because I picked out a few of you that I thought were particularly good. I'm like, yeah, you can get a prize. So I apologize to everybody who didn't get a prize, but I don't have a billion of them. So. Nonetheless, I appreciate all of your contributions, so thank you so much.
Let's give one round of applause for everyone who's contributed, both art and discussion. Woo! Yay!
Thanks, guys. But before we move on to the end of the podcast, I'd just like to announce we have an MVP for this book club. And we've decided to award the MVP to Mogaoscar. Congratulations.
Yay!
Wait, what? Really?
Yes,
really. I really didn't see that coming.
You've had some exceptional posts on the forum for this book club. Like, I haven't even had time to read your essay yet, but it's quite amazing.
And even though this is the last podcast, I'm still planning on expanding on that essay. And also, I'm sorry to not have finished it yet, but I was planning
it's literally
a whole
an essay.
Cover.
Like, no, but I don't but even. I'm, that's not even an exaggeration.
No, but actually, I mean, about the fan art, I was kind of. Italian about, I wasn't happy about not having submitted any fan art, and I was working on a Hope cover, which, well, since I'm not very good at piano, I've just been at it for, 4 months, my skills aren't so high, but once I finish it, I want to post a Hope cover.
We'll definitely look forward to it. Hope is one of, if not my favorite, BGMs in this game.
Yeah, I'm very excited to hear that. So thank you, Mogaoscar. As a prize, we're going to award you with a preliminary copy of Harmonia, which we'll award once the game's out. So you can look forward to that.
Thanks a lot. I'll be the first one in the book reading that and finishing that. I was really looking forward to Harmonia after reading Planetarium.
Yeah, well, that comes out very soon, so you can look forward to that when it finally does.
Yeah.
So, well,
thanks a lot, guys.
We've reached the end of the journey, guys. How does everyone feel?
Good. Feel good.
Great.
I feel
that life is... Yes. Kaite kimashite.
It's a wonderful life, yeah.
It's a wonderful...
So where do we go from here? Like, we've got Harmonia coming up very soon, but we also have that little other thing in Tomoyo After...
Dungeons and
Takafumi's. Oh dear. Are we doing a Dungeons and Takafumi's streaming session?
I'm definitely doing it next week.
Oh, I would love to see that.
Join me.
Yeah, I'll definitely join.
I mean, don't only watch. If someone wants to stream it, we can do kind
fucking
of a race.
I give up. I give up Dungeons and Takafumis. I have looped the first 5 stages like 5 times, and I give up so hard.
But then you get stronger each time.
Yes, I do.
Well, then I'll be happy to I'll be happy to
add. Oh no. Is this a meta to how Tomoyo had to loop Tomoya's life? Tomoyo's 1 week every time and she gets stronger every time and that's how you beat Dungeons and Takafumis.
Yeah.
God damn.
You share Tomoyo's pain.
God damn it.
It's actually a little bit fun. I've played a little bit of it, and I have quite enjoyed it, so I'm probably going to be playing more of that. I don't know if we're going to do an event or anything, but if we do, you can like keep up with it on the forum. I think we have a topic for Dungeons & Takafumis already, so you can definitely jump on that. And the quest for the lucky Takafumi begins.
On Steam. Time to get all those foil training cards.
Yeah, also.
And you also got to get the foil cards to get the lucky Takafumi Steam badge.
Are you on track to winning that tasking?
I don't know. It's going to cost a lot of money. I don't know if I want to pay $35 for a Steam badge. That's more than Tomoyo After.
But it's there, a Steam badge.
Yeah. I'll think about it maybe someday, but no immediate plans. Yeah, so thank you everybody once again for joining us for this amazing book club. I am very excited to get into the Harmonia Book Club coming very soon.
Oh, wait, what? We're doing a book club for Harmonia?
Oh.
Wait.
I already announced this.
Why wouldn't we?
Yeah. Yes, guys, we're doing a Harmonia Book Club. So this is a big thing for us because we haven't really done a new key visual novel before for a book club. But I feel like it's an excellent incentive to anybody looking at this game and wanting a place to discuss it and read it. I feel like it's going to be a really cool event. So when's that coming up, you may be wondering? Well, I can officially announce that the date of the Harmonia Book Club will be commencing on the 3rd of October.
Oh, yes.
Nice. I think I haven't decided how long it'll run for yet. Two weeks, maybe 3 weeks. Depending on how long it is.
I guess that those 10 days we can use to gauge how long we should organize it. I'm sure if it's not that long, many of our readers will finish it before the book club even starts.
Yeah, but even so, like, even if you do finish it early, you can still like participate in the discussion on the forum. And then if you want to be on the podcast, please let me know. We're looking for more guests and stuff. So, yeah. I'm quite excited to read new keywork. It's makes my heart ducky.
It's been so long.
It has been so long since we've had an original IP that isn't an anime.
This has been the first time I was actually around for a new key visual novel.
Yeah?
Yeah. Rewrite was out before I got into visual novels.
Yeah, this will be the first for a lot of people. A lot of people got in after Rewrite came out. Yeah, wow. So that's super exciting. Yeah, I don't have a lot of details to announce. I don't even know if we have a logo yet. If Kiketsuki Mii managed to make a logo, then it'll probably be in the video right now, but I can't make any promises. So we'll see. But yeah, so get hyped for that. It's happening on the 3rd of October, and you can expect lots of awesome Harmonia discussion. Thank you for joining us once more, everybody, and we hope you had a wonderful book club.
I hope you enjoy it, Tomoyo After, even just half as much as I did.
I'm not afraid of the dark.